Hello people, in this video we want to look at diabetic retinopathy. This is an important topic in ophthalmology. Basically, let us try to break up these terms. First of all, diabetic retinopathy, right? So first of all, what is diabetes? Diabetes is chronic hyperglycemia, right? This is a metabolic disorder. So there are a lot of types in this, type 1, type 2, gestational, and other types, right? So basically this is chronic hyperglycemia. That is more sugar, you can say, in local term. Then what is retina? Retina is basically, it is the sensory membrane that lines the inner surface of the back of the eyeball. So if this is your eyeball, what you can see here. So inner surface of the back of the eyeball. So this will become the retina, correct? So the retina has many layers. So what is diabetic retinopathy? Pathy is any pathology, right? Something is wrong here, some problem here. So basically, because of this excess sugar, that is hyperglycemia, chronic hyperglycemia, there can be some problems in the retina. So this is diabetic retinopathy. So guys, if you remember our pathology videos where we have explained because of diabetes mellitus what happens, you would have seen the changes, right? So vascular changes, metabolic changes, immune. So basically in vascular, you have seen that macrovascular, microvascular. So here you have to see that there is problem to retina because of this microvascular changes, that is microangiopathy, retinopathy, this you have already seen, okay? So metabolic, there can be sorbitol. Sorbitol can cause a problem to the eye, right? What else have you seen here? So all this in pathology we have already completed. In pathology, we have also seen that because of the protein glycosylation, so protein plus this glucose, protein glycosylation, there can be again retinopathy. So you're seeing already here, because of microangiopathy, retinopathy, because of sorbitol, some problem with the lens of the eye, and because of protein glycosylation, retinopathy. So all this we have already seen in the pathology videos. So as a complication of diabetes, we have already seen that retinopathy can happen. Cataract can happen, right? That is lens change. So why it happens, all that is given here. Non-enzymatic protein glycosylation. So without the enzyme. So you can see here, this photo and all we have already seen in the diabetes video. So protein is becoming glycosylated protein. That is what is hemoglobin becomes HbA1c. You can see that here, written here. Hemoglobin becomes HbA1c, etc. Right? So this is one thing. Then you have the glucose turning into sorbitol. So sorbitol and fructose can be formed. So all this you should know. So hope you have got an introduction to diabetic retinopathy. So now let us look at who are at risk here. Okay. So people who have diabetes. So basically 10 years, 20 years, 30 years of diabetes, right? 30 years if they have diabetes, then definitely whether it is type 1 diabetes or type 2 diabetes, definitely they will develop retinopathy, 95% cases. So you know that diabetes mellitus, we have type 1, type 2, gestational diabetes mellitus, others, etc. Type 1 will be seen in young people and type 2 will be in older people, guys. So basically here you just understand one thing, duration. If duration is more, the chances of retinopathy is more, as simple as that, okay. This duration they are taking after the onset of puberty, right, that duration, if that duration is more, the retinopathy risk is more, okay. Now, let us look at the age of onset of diabetes also as access risk factor. Obviously, again here they're talking that after puberty, from when it comes, the duration that matters, okay. Now, let us go to the risk factor, poor metabolic control. So, obviously, how people are maintaining their sugar levels. Hereditary. This is, they are telling it is a recessive trait and it is more, you can see, in proliferative retinopathy, okay. And more you will see in proliferative retinopathy, that is a type, we will come to that. Then pregnancy, basically some people can get gestational diabetes mellitus, right, that is only during pregnancy they have diabetes mellitus. So this also can accelerate the retinopathy. Now hypertension. People who have associated hypertension obviously can have more diabetic retinopathy. You already have seen hypertension, hypertensive retinopathy. We already have covered the videos. Other risk factors like smoking, anemia, obesity, hyperlipidemia, right? So let's look at this slide again. Guys, let's just revise these risk factors. So if duration is more, then their chances of retinopathy are more irrespective of the type of diabetes. Age of onset of diabetes after puberty, the duration matters. Poor metabolic control, obviously, if you're able to control your sugars, good, otherwise bad. Heredity, a recessive trait, especially proliferative retinopathy. Pregnancy can accelerate this retinopathy. Hypertension also can accelerate it. Other risk factors can be smoking, obesity, anemia, and hyperlipidemia. So guys, we are moving on to the pathogenesis. What exactly happens, the pathology we'll look at. So basically hyperglycemia, this is the starting point. Excess sugar level, you can say. Glucose levels are high. Hyperglycemia, this is the starting point of diabetic retinopathy. Now let us move on to the second point here, microangiopathy. Basically the capillaries, arterioles, all these are venules are all damaged. Now why does this happen? Let us look at the causes. So the biggest cause is the hyperglycemia, right? Now let us look at this, what exactly this leads to. The cell damage. There is cellular damage. So how does cellular damage happen? Because of this hyperglycemia, there is damage to the cells of the retina, endothelial cells, loss of pericytes, thickening of basement membrane, of capillaries. Why all this is happening? Why the cells are getting damaged? Because of sorbitol accumulation. So what is accumulating here, guys? Sorbitol accumulation. So we have already seen in our diabetes video. See here, glucose will become what? Sorbitol. How? Because of aldose reductase. So sorbitol will accumulate in the cells due to aldose reductase mediated glycolysis. Okay. So glucose is being broken down. They are saying because of this aldose reductase glycolysis. This is glycolysis. Aldose reductase mediated glycolysis. Sorbitol will accumulate. Now this sorbitol is causing the cell damage. Right. So let's come back to our PPT currently. Sorbitol accumulation is one of the reasons for cellular damage. Shall we move on, people, to the next point? Advanced glycation end. Advanced glycation end, AGE product accumulates. That is nothing but same thing, guys. Proteins plus glucose. All these are glycation products will accumulate. Right? We already saw that. We have seen so many things like this. So you saw hemoglobin itself can get glycosylation of hemoglobin. The crystalline lens in the eye, that those proteins can get glycosylated, right? So basement membrane, we already spoke of that. So this is age, advanced glycosylation end products. Nothing new for you. You have seen all these in the previous videos. Coming to the next point here, which causes cellular damage, activation of several protein kinase C isoforms. What is this? So it just looks like there is some protein kinase C. The isoforms of these are getting activated, which is causing cell damage. Okay. Then excessive oxidative stress to the cells because of free radicals. That also we have seen in our diabetes mellitus video. See here, excessive free oxygen radicals. You remember? From the pathology videos of diabetes mellitus, excessive free or oxygen radicals, these will cause what? Damage to the cells. Correct, right? So microangiopathy. Why microangiopathy will happen? Because of cell damage and because of hematological and biochemical changes induced by hyperglycemia. Cellular damage, also hyperglycemia. Because of that only, cells are getting damaged. And hematological. What is hematological? Blood. Hematological and biochemical changes induced by hyperglycemia. So what is microangiopathy? Micro, small vessels, angio, vessels, pathy, problems. Small vessels will have problems. All these small capillaries, venules, arterioles, all these will have problems. You can see that here, right? Now let us look at this hematological and biochemical changes. Means what? The blood, changes in the blood, right? Changes in the blood, biochemical changes. Let us see, because of hyperglycemia, what is happening. So this diagram should be helpful for you to understand. The platelets are all sticking to each other, platelet adhesiveness. Then the RBCs are undergoing, they are deforming, they are going into Rolex formation. So what happens if RBCs are sticking to each other, etc.? Blood viscosity increases, the blood is more viscous, it can't flow so easily. Then you have serum lipids altered abnormally. Actually, insulin protects lipids. If insulin will stop lipid lipolysis. But if there is no insulin, there will be lipolysis. Okay. Then leukostasis increases. What is stasis? Stasis means something not moving. Basically, these cells are accumulating. Okay. And they are going to damage all these microvasculature. Right. That's what you should understand. then fibrinolysis increases. So fibrinolysis, one thing good only, right? So basically what is happening here, right, in fibrinolysis, guys, usually, right, whenever our blood is flowing here, if there is a small break here, even internally, it will try to keep fixing them with these clots. But whenever there is fibrinolysis, these clots cannot be made. So there can be hemorrhage, right? So that is what probably has been shown here, right? All these hemorrhages you can see, because fibrinolysis increases. So there can be no clot, right? So this is the pathogenesis, exactly what has happened because of hyperglycemia, microangiopathy, cellular damage, changes in the blood, hematological changes, biochemical changes. Biochemical refers to more like lipid, right? The serum lipids are altered, etc. So now you have understood. So this is the starting of all this, basically we have told. Now what happens because of the microangiopathy? What is the effect of this microangiopathy? Let's go to that. So, effects of microangiopathy. So, just one more point here in the textbook they have mentioned is leukostasis increases because of what? Because of one ICAM1 molecule. Okay, that is increased because of this ICAM1. That is ICAM1 means this has increased. What has increased? Intracameral adhesion molecule. Okay, this has increased, it seems, because of which only all these problems of leukostasis. Okay. So people, are you understanding? We are going step by step. Hyperglycemia has happened in these people. So now we have seen that there's microangiopathy. Now why microangiopathy has happened also we have seen. Now we will see the effects of microangiopathy. Okay. So what exactly happens because of this microangiopathy? So what will happen? Breakdown of blood retinal barrier, weakened capillary wall, microvascular occlusions. So breakdown of blood retinal barrier means what? So this blood is kind of oozing out into the retina. So if the retina has some blood supply, so this blood and retinal barrier is going out. So there is, let us say, some hemorrhage, edema, leakage of lipids also can happen. That is hard exudate, right? All this can happen. This is breakdown of blood retinal barrier. What and all will be there? Edema means, you know, right, there is fluid that is coming out here. Then hemorrhage means blood itself, RBCs, all this come out, right? That is hemorrhage. Then lipids can come, that will become, they will form what? Hard exudates. Lipids itself, if they come out, that will become hard exudates. Okay, so this is one of the problem because of microangiopathy. Then weakened capillary wall. So this produces what? If the capillary wall is weak, now let us say this is a capillary and the wall is weak, so it will form a aneurysm, right? So that kind of balloon kind of thing, you know, right? Aneurysm. So this will become an aneurysm. So this one is an aneurysm now. This is very important. This is something that they will observe in the fundus examination. What is it? Microaneurysm. Hemorrhage also can happen because of this weakened capillary wall. So aneurysm means, you know, right? Like if this is a blood vessel, it's kind of a ballooning, right? This kind of a ballooning of the blood, the wall of this will form something called as an aneurysm. So this will be a very weak structure. It can rupture and lead to hemorrhage. Then you have microvascular occlusions. What do you mean by this? So this microvasculature, that is the capillaries, venules, arterioles, all these can get occluded. That means they're getting blocked, right? Occluded. Inside they have got blocked. So what will happen if these got occluded? So this is supplying something. Now this got occluded. Now what will happen? It will lead to ischemia. So this one, whoever is there on the receiving end, this fellow will undergo ischemia, no blood for him, and he will undergo some infarct. Can happen, right? And whenever there is this kind of occlusion, right, guys, so it can also form a, like if there is an occlusion here, there can also be a shunt that is formed, like an AV shunt. So some neovascularization, right, AV shunts can form. So it is a, between an artery and a vein, the shunt can form. This is AV shunt, okay? Intraretinal microvascular abnormalities. These are what? Intraretinal, within the retina, within the layers of the retina, microvasculature has some abnormalities like these AV shunts, etc. That is what will happen if there is microvascular occlusions. Yes, is this clear? So we were talking about the blood vessel changes. What happens because of this hyperglycemia? Now, because of these blood vessel changes, because of this microangiopathy, what is happening? There is a hemorrhage, edema, leakage of lipids into the retina, right? And there can be microaneurysms, which can rupture, lead to hemorrhage. There can be occlusions of these microvasculature, which can lead to ischemia, that will lead to infarct. There can be AV shunts. All these are intraretinal microvascular abnormalities, IRME. Okay. So till here we have completed, guys. So still what and all can happen? Neovascularization of retina, right? So we will see some new blood vessels are coming in, looks like, in the retina. Then in this we have to look at pro-angiogenic factors, deletion of anti-angiogenic factors. So this will cover the pathogenesis, guys. Now let us move on. We'll have to look at in the next videos, we'll have to look at the classification of diabetic retinopathy, non-proliferative diabetic retinopathy, proliferative diabetic retinopathy. Proliferative is important for the exam. They have asked this several times. Then you have diabetic maculopathy, advanced diabetic eye disease. All this we have to look at. So how will you manage a diabetic retinopathy case? So basically you will have to control their glucose levels, control the glycemia, control the dyslipidemia. You can do some renal function tests for these people. Then you can check for associated anemia, hypertension, lifestyle changes. So many drugs are there, like intravitreal, that means into the vitreous they are giving some drugs, looks like. Then some steroids, laser therapy, surgery, treatment, lot of options are there. Okay, so all this we will continue in the next video, guys. In this video, what and all we looked at, diabetic retinopathy, what exactly the terminology means we have looked at. Then we have looked at the risk factors, who are at more risk. Then we looked at the pathogenesis, mainly this increasing blood sugar, right, hyperglycemia will lead to microangiopathy, will lead to breakdown of the blood retinal barrier, weakened capillary walls, microvascular occlusions leading to ischemia, infarct, AV shunts, etc. Neovascularization of retina, guys. So this is something that we have not gone into much detail, but anyways, this is a part of the pathogenesis. So look at this. Neovascularization means new blood vessels. So there are some things which are going to help this. Pro-angiogenic factors. So what are these factors? VEGF, that is vasculoendothelial growth factors. Then you have platelet derived growth factor, hepatocyte growth factor, all these which are released because of ischemia, because of these microvascular occlusions that lead to ischemia. Whenever there is ischemia, as a result of ischemia, there can be all these neovascularization. These growth factors will come out and they will help the angiogenesis, okay, that is neovascularization. So guys, new blood vessels are forming. So whenever there is this microvascular occlusion, there will be ischemia here. So there will be some AV shunts that is formed or new blood vessels which come out, okay. So that will be helped by what? The vasculoendothelial growth factor, platelet-derived growth factor, hepatocyte growth factor, okay. These factors are also released because of oxidative stress, right, activation of these protein kinase C and cytokines. You have already seen all that here. If you remember, these terms are not new for you. You saw that here, protein kinase C, because of this one, because of oxidative stress, because of all these things, these growth factors will become more and there will be proangiogenesis. Okay, so these are all proangiogenic factors. Now, what are the ones that are going to make sure that these factors don't go away? Deletion of anti-angiogenic factors. So some people are out there to destroy these people, right? Those people have to get destroyed now. So basically these are some factors, guys, and endostatin, angiostatin, pigment epithelial derived factor, thrombospondin 1 and platelet factor 4. Looks like all these are anti-angiogenic factors. We don't want any anti-angiogenic factors now because we want angiogenesis. So all these have to be deleted. So these also, all these things will help in neovascularization of retina. So this story has stopped at this level where we have completed the pathogenesis. Now, in the next video, what we have to look at, guys? We have to look at the classification, that we have to look at the details of each of these types of diabetic retinopathy. It's going to be a long journey, guys. So let's continue in the next video. That's all for now. Bye bye.